For an entire generation, people have experienced Star Wars the only way it's been possible, on the TV screen. But if you've only seen it this way, you haven't seen it at all.
What started as the biggest phenomenon to have swept moviegoers off their feet in 1977 has since evolved into one of the most important pieces of modern popular culture. This is honestly quite the stuck-up statement. Still, it's true, and not even from a certain point of view. Over the next hour, we'll be investigating, dissecting, and disseminating the culture of Star Wars. We'll start by uncovering how George Lucas came up with such imaginative mythology. Then, we'll be focusing on how the first Star Wars impacted America in 1977. After that, we'll discuss the fan impact of four decades of Star Wars. And then finally, we'll come face to face with the philosophy, metaphors, and spiritual nature of the series, which is often overlooked, in favor of other aspects of the franchise. So, without further dudes, it's time we execute Order 69.
Star Wars producer-director George Lucas.
About 10 years ago, I set out to write a children's film. I had an idea of doing a modern fairy tale. I stumbled across a hero with a thousand faces. After reading more of Joe's books, I began to understand how I could do this. It was a great gift, and a very important moment. If I don't, you know, it's possible that if I hadn't run across that, I would still be writing Star Wars today.
While some assume that Star Wars was written just to tell an entertaining and enthralling story, the reality is that George Lucas created the saga as a means of repurposing, reinvigorating, and simplifying existing myths and religions from all over the world. His aim was not to create a new religion, but a new myth. Lucas believes that religious stories and myths are created to help us understand ourselves and the world around us. Many fans are familiar with the first Star Wars having been inspired by Akira Kurosawa's The Hidden Fortress. As a matter of fact, the samurai and Japanese cultural influences on the series are very well known. But the mythological, spiritual, and religious influences are rarely discussed by fans. And yet, they are just as big, if not a bigger part of how the Star Wars saga came to be. George Lucas was fascinated by the fact that religions and myths that originated lands apart from one another all shared commonalities, or were more or less direct copies of one another. His belief is that religions and myths are telling psychological stories about human nature, which is a belief that's shared by author and professor Joseph Campbell, who was a huge influence on George Lucas. In Lucas's own words, "I came to the conclusion after American Graffiti that what's valuable for me is to set standards, not to show people the world the way it is. Around the period of this realization, it came to me that there really was no modern use of mythology. The Western was possibly the last generically American fairy tale, telling us about our values. And once the Western disappeared, nothing has ever taken its place. In literature, we were going off into science fiction. So that's when I started doing more strenuous research on fairy tales, folklore, and mythology. I started reading Joe's books. Before that, I hadn't read any of Joe's books. It was very eerie because in reading The Hero with a Thousand Faces, I began to realize that my first draft of Star Wars was following classic motifs. So I modified my next draft according to what I'd been learning about classical motifs and made it a little bit more consistent. I went on to read The Masks of God and many other books. As for where the Force came from and George's opinions on it, well, I'll let good old Georgie boy explain that one himself.
Where did the idea of Force come from?
The whole thing in Star Wars was to take, ideas, psychological ideas, from social issues, political issues, spiritual issues, and condense them down into an easy to tell story of those stories. The Force basically came from, distilling all of the religious beliefs, spiritual beliefs, go all around the world, all through time, finding the similarities, and then creating an easy to deal with metaphor for what religion is. And the point was that in the very beginning, when you have people worshiping rocks and deer, they called it life force. They called it the Force. That's what it was. And so where did the name come from? It came from basically life force, of what the more primitive religions believed in. And then you go through all the other religions and they have the same thing. You know, it's all the same, you know, whether you believe in God, don't believe in God, believe in religion, don't believe in religion. The issue is that you either don't believe there's anything else out there, which is a little, I think, would be hard to live with at the same time. I mean, I believe something's out there, I just don't know what it is. I have no idea, or would I dare to guess, but I do know that religions aren't based on it. They're human psychological needs that have been put together mostly to create a society. Star Wars and Indiana Jones were basically put together, especially Star Wars, more than Indiana Jones. Indiana Jones was just done for fun, to entertain people. And there were some messages in there about, archaeology, and also about what we believe in terms of myths, right, and that right. sort of thing. But the real one is Star Wars, and that was done in the same vein that what I was saying about the patron creates the propaganda, and what I wanted to do was go back to some of the older propaganda, which was consistent through all of the societies, which is mythology, but to say, what did they all believe? Because they were all, this propaganda was created independently.
Yeah.
And what are the things that they all actually believed? We're talking about relationships with your father, relationships with your society, your history, relationships with the gods. All of this stuff it's old, but they're psychological motifs that were created through storytelling, primarily oral storytelling, that explained what they believed in and who they believed in. So what I wanted to do is go back and find the psychological motifs that underlie that, because those grow out of a popularism, and to say that not all, but a majority of people, boys, have a certain psychological relationship with their fathers. And that's been going on through history, and trying to explain that to say, we know your darkest secret.
Yeah.
And therefore, you're part of us, because we all know the same things.
I am so excited about Star Wars.
Fuzzy man of Star Wars.
Screw that.
Hey, Foreman, man, this thing better be good. If I don't see some space jugs, I'm gonna be super pissed.
I don't know, guys, I hear it's okay.
Well, there's no way it's better than the Planet of the Apes.
I mean, those apes were really good actors.
Hey,
Yes. I'm well aware that folks had stopped using that groovy word by 77. But come on, man. I just dig the groovy tune it makes when that word escapes my lips. Whoa. I think this trip to the 70s gave me a contact high. The 70s were a crazy time. If you think 2020 was a screwy year, the 70s were basically a decade of that-ish. Naturally, the movies of that day reflected the dour, serious, and depressing nature of 70s reality. That was until Star Wars broke every record, and as some urban legends would have you believe, busted literal blocks from the wait of fans who were standing in line, waiting sometimes all day just to see the mammoth phenomenon known only as Star Wars at that time. Moviegoers of the day had never seen anything like Star Wars. Sure, there were sci-fi fantasies and plenty of adventures featuring out-of-this-world concepts, but none of that was what captivated audiences in the 70s. It was the atmosphere, the film's uplifting vibrations, as well as the idea of an underdog taking on a corrupt empire, all to restore peace and harmony to the galaxy. The angst and fear of the 70s had their volume turned down by John Williams' bombastic score and George Lucas's devotion to set positive examples for the distressed and often volatile youth of the 1970s. The youth of the 70s would naturally be quite volatile when the nation was on the verge of falling apart. These youths also included many young men who lost their minds, lives, or the lives of their friends or family to the fruitless war in Vietnam. Even the adults of that era were becoming fed up with the government and the general state of decay that the country had wallowed in for so long by that point. Star Wars marked a shift in American culture. While the country was not flawless, and to be honest, none of the actual problems had even been fixed, and yet, something just as wonderful and equally incredible happened. People started to become happy again. Star Wars gets to take credit for this shift, because even those who did not care for the Star Wars reaped the benefits that Star Wars brought to the movie industry. Star Wars proved there was a demand and need for uplifting, positive, inspiring stories. Movies began empowering people, lifting them out of their depressing and downtrodden lives. And that gave them the boost of happiness they needed to have the courage and strength to dig this country out of the gutter.
Star Wars. It is more than just a successful movie, it is a box office phenomenon. The film is breaking attendance records all over the country. Not since Jaws have so many people stood in line to see a movie. Alan Ladd Jr., an executive at 20th Century Fox, whose film it is, talked about the reasons for its appeal.
I think it's just good and evil. The simplicity of the whole story is what really makes it work. It's a fantasy, and I think we all grew up in a fantasy world, and I think that it works on that level.
Star Wars cost $9 million to produce. It will bring in at least 10 times that amount. As a result, the price of 20th Century Fox stock has doubled in the last 2 weeks. There are no sex scenes in Star Wars. Unlike Jaws, it doesn't frighten people. It's just an old-fashioned cowboy movie set in space with mind-boggling special effects. In the classic westerns, it's the good guys versus the bad guys, sometimes a pair of good guys, one experienced and a little cynical, the other a tenderfoot, a kid.
Got him! I got him!
In Star Wars, their names are Han Solo and Luke Skywalker. The bad guys always are a rough, tough, sinister-looking bunch. And never more so than in Star Wars. The damsel in distress. That's Princess Leia, who is held captive by the bad guys. Sometimes the good guys have a sidekick who provides the comic relief.
Come on.
In Star Wars, the sidekicks are two robots. And Chewbacca, who somehow knows how to pilot a spaceship. The climax of every good cowboy movie is the final showdown between the good guys and the bad guys. The only difference in Star Wars is that the characters ride spaceships instead of horses.
I'll be right there.
A cowboy movie set in space, that's Star Wars. It's old-fashioned, escapist entertainment, pure and simple, with no moral, no message. And it appears this is what just about everybody in the country is in the mood for. Douglas Kiker, NBC News, Washington.
So, Jackie, you want to go see Star Wars tonight?
But Michael, I told you I don't like space.
Jackie, if we're going to start our relationship over, you got to meet me halfway, honey.
Well, maybe I want to do something else tonight.
Like what? God, Jackie. We can do that for the rest of our lives. Star Wars is a limited engagement.
Fine, fine, but I want the big popcorn.
Did Luke Skywalker...
Oh, would you stop? Luke Skywalker this, Luke Skywalker that. I'm sick of hearing about that little fruit.
Luke Skywalker is not! He and Leia clearly...
Skywalker Ranch. It started as the ultimate heist.
Linus laid the whole thing out in fifth grade.
What's your game plan?
We storm the ranch or we die trying.
This is a suicide mission.
It will become the ultimate road trip.
Strap in, fellas.
Star Wars!
It may be crazy.
Yeah!
It may be dangerous.
Bam, bam, bam! Yeah!
Gary Knowles.
Which one of you is Windows?
I'm Windows. Nice to meet you.
Harry Knowles is kicking windows in.
But if you make the right connections...
It's all there. Maps, passcodes.
How did you score all this stuff?
Are you kidding? I'm William Shatner. I can score anything.
The possibilities...
You want to take your shirt off.
As you wish.
Warm.
Hutch private convo.
Dude, get out of here. It's not a good time. The force is strong with me here.
...are endless.
Somebody tell me what the damn red button's for!
It's light speed, kid.
Light speed.
Yeah. Punch it!
Featuring Princess Leia, Lando Calrissian, Darth Maul, Shooter McGavin, the warehouse guy from The Office, the guy from Tropic Thunder, Jay, the guy from Die Hard 4, the hot chick from Sin City, and Captain James T. Kirk.
Friend of yours?
Fanboys.
Help!
Come on!
Quick, get into the garbage chute!
I have a bad feeling about this.
You guys don't think that the,
We are in George Lucas's trash room.
The walls are not gonna close in on us.
Ah! Why?
It's safe to say that we're living in the Star Wars generation. No other piece of popular culture has ever come close to the mammoth cultural impact that the Star Wars films have had. I understand some Harry Potter fans will be irked by that statement, but the simple fact is this: Harry Potter likely would not exist, or at the very least, be what it is today, without the legacy that Star Wars started in '77. films like Harry Potter and the Marvel movies would, in all likelihood, be seen as pointless children's fare without Star Wars first having established the importance, love, and need for inspiring stories that lift us out of our humdrum lives. Truth be told, without Star Wars proving the commercial viability of these types of stories, I'm not sure the Marvel movies or Harry Potter films would exist today. But more than that, what kind of world would we have without Star Wars? Okay, that was a bit dramatic, perhaps. But what would our lives be without Star Wars having made such a humongous and lasting impact on them? How many of our first memories revolve around Star Wars? For me, one of my most cherished memories is the fact that my first movie theater experience was seeing Return of the Jedi in 1997. I was only 5 at the time, and I remember really not understanding what was going on, but also loving every single second. Especially the climactic battle aboard Jabba's sand barge, the awesome, badass, adorable Ewoks, but most of all, Luke and Vader's epic duel of love and rage. For some of us, maybe the Super Star Wars games are our first video game experience. Or perhaps it was a Star Wars novel that was the first book we really read and sunk our teeth into. Or maybe that lightsaber toy was the thing we grabbed when the world seemed scary, when we felt lost, or when hope was nowhere to be found. For many of us, that's why we watch the films, play the games, and listen to the wonderful tunes that have scored almost our entire lives. For others, it's merely entertainment. Though even those others would agree that it's probably the most entertaining thing around. Nothing else ever came close to capturing the imagination of literal millions like the Star Wars did. There are few things that connect people the way Star Wars can. While the fan base is more divided than ever, one thing is certain. Star Wars is more powerful than we could possibly imagine. There is nothing that comes close to inspiring the amount of love, hate, and joy that Star Wars has cultivated over the years. If you doubt that stuck-up statement, just take a look at the Star Wars subreddit, and you'll see what I mean.
This will be your last chance to own the original version of Star Wars, the George Lucas masterpiece that launched the Star Wars trilogy. The Force is forever, for all generations.
I'm interested in how does the visionary process work for you? Do you begin with the end in mind, or does it come to you in pieces of dreams?
When you're dealing with fantasy and it comes out of nowhere, mm-hmm. it's really, really hard. You have a theme that you want to deal with, and as opposed to, say, American Graffiti, which came out of my life, yeah. and you just write the story, and, and I wrote that in 3 weeks. Star Wars took me a couple years.
Is this after reading Joseph Campbell's?
Yeah, well, I'd taken a class in mythology when I was in college.
Yes.
When I went to write Star Wars, obviously, Joe Campbell was one of the best comparative mythologists
right.
that existed.
Yeah.
And
Love Joe Campbell.
At 19, George Lucas came across a book that would change his life forever. He read Joseph Campbell's The Hero with a Thousand Faces, about the ties between religion and myth. The book inspired an idea that would become Star Wars, George's own modern myth about the forces of good and evil set in a galaxy far, far away.
He is certainly one who we can say made Following Your Bliss mainstream. Every single person who is super successful always says that in some form, that following your bliss or following your passion is the way for you to be the most successful and empowered person.
It's a thing of, you know, don't listen to your peers. Don't listen to the authority figures in your life, your parents. And don't listen to the culture. Only listen to yourself. That's where you're going to find the truth.
Yes. It's what Kenobi said to Luke Skywalker. Trust your feelings.
Trust your feelings.
Use the Force.
Your mythology is really a way for society to... there are stories that are told to the people in the society to make them into a society so that they have a common belief system. And you do that not by giving them a bunch of lessons, but to give them heroes, people who we admire, who we want to emulate, and they do things wrong, and you say, don't do those things wrong, do these things. This is what these are what friendships mean. We know you have these feelings about your father, it's not a secret, and your mother. And you know, there's a lot of psychology involved in it. But they would pass these things along, and then the society would have a common history. And it would be bigger than life. And they would all join together, and they would use that, you know, to make their society function.
What interests you about the conflict between good and evil?
Well, the conflict between good and evil is the basic conflict. The universal question is, am I a good person? I mean, not counting social misfits, of course, or...
People like you and me.
Yeah. No. I mean,
Are you a good person?
I try to be a good person, but of course, that's a very complicated question.
It is,
and it's something you have to ponder because you're doing it every day. You're saying, should I do this or shouldn't I do this? Now, through mythology and things, we're taught certain things that are good and certain things that are bad, but a thinking person questions all that and say, is this really good? Am I really doing the right thing here? Am I really being a kind, compassionate person? Because to me, that's really about a compassionate person as opposed to a person that is consumed with self-interest or a selfish person. Those are the two things.
Mm-hmm.
We all have good and evil in us because we have the selfish side of us and we have the compassionate side of us. The idea is, how do you keep those things in balance? And by keeping those things in balance, you can do a lot of good things.
Breathe. Just breathe. Reach out with your feelings. What do you see?
The island. Life. Death and decay. That feeds new life. Warmth. Cold. Peace. Violence.
And between it all,
balance and energy. A force.
And inside you.
Inside me. That same force.
You do nothing that I say.
Master, moving stones around is one thing. This is totally different.
No different. Only different in your mind. You must unlearn what you have learned.
All right, I'll give it a try.
No, try not. Do or do not. There is no try.
It's too big.
Size matters not. Look at me. Judge me by my size, do you? And where you should not. For my ally is the Force. And a powerful ally it is. Life creates it. Makes it grow. Its energy surrounds us and binds us. Luminous beings are we, not this crude matter. You must feel the Force around you. Here, between you, me, the tree, the rock, everywhere. Yes, even between the land and the ship.
You want the impossible.
Disrespect, Master, it's the truth.
From your point of view?
The boy is dangerous. They all sense it. Why can't you?
His fate is uncertain. He's not dangerous. The Council will decide Anakin's future. That should be enough for you. Now get on board.
Qui-Gon, sir. I don't want to be a problem.
You won't be any. I'm not allowed to train you. So I want you to watch me and be mindful. Always remember, your focus determines your reality. Stay close to me, and you'll be safe.
Master, sir, I heard Yoda talking about midichlorians. I've been wondering, what are midichlorians?
Midichlorians are a microscopic life form that resides within all living cells.
They live inside me.
Inside your cells, yes. And we are symbionts with them.
Symbionts?
Life forms living together for mutual advantage. Without the midichlorians, life could not exist, and we would have no knowledge of the Force. They continually speak to us, telling us the will of the Force. When you learn to quiet your mind, you'll hear them speaking to you.
I don't understand.
With time and training, Annie, you will. You will.
Does a movie like Star Wars fill some of that need for the spiritual adventure, for the hero?
Oh, it's perfect. It does the cycle perfectly. It's not simple morality play. It has to do with the powers of life and their inflection through the action of man. One of the wonderful things, I think, about this adventure into space is that the narrator, the artist, the one thinking up the story, is in a field that is not covered by our own knowledges.
Do you, when you look at something like Star Wars, recognize some of the themes of the hero throughout mythology?
Well, I think that George Lucas was using standard mythological figures. The old man as the advisor. Well, specifically, what he made me think of is the Japanese swordmaster.
Remember, a Jedi can feel the Force flowing through him.
I've known some of those people, and this man has a bit their character.
Well, there's something mythological, too, isn't there, in the sense that the hero is helped by this stranger who shows up and gives him some instrument, a sword or a sheaf of light, shaft of light.
He gives him not only a physical instrument, but a psychological commitment and a psychological center.
This time, let go your conscious self and act on instinct.
Well, he had him exercising with that strange weapon and then pulled the mask over. That's real Japanese stuff.
I'll take them myself.
When I took our two sons to see it, they did the same thing the audience did at that moment when the voice of Ben Kenobi says to Luke Skywalker in the climactic moment,
use the Force, Luke. Let go, Luke.
the audience broke out into
they did
elation into applause.
Well, you see, this thing communicates. It is in a language that is talking to young people today, and that's marvelous.
If one word sums up the feeling of the Star Wars franchise, it would be hope. If there was one word to describe the meaning of the franchise, it would be faith. George Lucas was not promoting a religion or even a spiritual belief system, although, given the inspirations for the series, most of all, given the fact that Lucas was obsessed with ancient cultures, myths, religions, and the spirituality of the world, one would be foolish to assume you could not find faith, religion, or a belief system within Star Wars. In fact, many already have. Jediism has existed mostly in the UK, but also abroad since 2001. At that time, a bunch of geeks throughout Europe thought it would be a really funny idea to put Jedi on the national census as their chosen religion. Naturally, this started more or less as a prank, but it evolved into something else entirely. Jediism is seen as a way of life, or philosophy for self-control, self-improvement, and as a calling to dedicating oneself to a higher cause and ideal, namely, the promotion of a positive mindset, as well as teaching compassion and self-assuredness. Physical and mental fitness through Jedi meditation is another key component of Jediism, which can also include lightsaber training. Of course, they train for fun and to put on shows. They do not train to fight evil, nor do they think they can use the Force like in the films. Think of Jediism like the Jedi Council. For most of them, this is about diplomacy, democracy, and philosophy. And for some of them, it does involve a devoted belief in the Force. No, they're not going to Jedi mind trick you into bed, because that would be a total Sith move. Of course, those without knowledge of religions other than Christianity would not see the Force for what Lucas intended it to be. For most, it's magical mumbo jumbo, and nothing else. But those who know of Hinduism, Native American belief systems, Taoism, Buddhism, Islam, Gnosticism, quantum mechanics, the power of manifestation, the laws of attraction, and countless other religious systems, stories, ideas, and concepts, will see a totally different film than those who only think of Jedi as lightsaber-wielding samurai. For younglings and Padawans, Star Wars is about lightsabers and space battles. For Jedi with a love of history, philosophy, and spiritual study, Star Wars is solely about the Force, and what faith in something greater than yourself can do for you and the universe. No, I'm not recruiting for the Jedi. After all, being a Jedi is a choice. It's not like I would use some horrible scare tactics to try and convince you that you have to join, or else. Who on earth would do something like that? Using fear to convince people to believe in something. I mean, other than the Sith, of course. Obviously, if you have a faith that works for you, then the Force could help you comprehend that faith in a new way, or simply deepen your faith by seeing your concepts and ideals discussed through new terminology. The Force does not replace spiritual ideas you already have. It's not a new faith or new religion. It's simply a new method of understanding the mythical, mystical, and magical forces at work in our world. For those who do not put stock or devotion into the dying art of spirituality? The Force can be seen as a tool to understand the point of religions. While you can view the Force, or any belief, as metaphorical or simply as philosophy, the fact is, those things are faith, spirituality, and religion to other people. Instead of laughing at those things, why not try to understand that some people need faith to make it through the day? Faith is believing you'll find a way to pay the rent. Faith is trusting that the world is not going to hell in a handbasket. Faith is what a parent has when their newborn takes a turn for the worst. Star Wars is a great tool to understand the importance and reasons for faith. In particular, Disney's Star Wars seems to be directly promoting faith and spirituality. Nearly everything Disney has made in the Star Wars universe thus far has included a massive focus on the Force, spirituality, meditation, mindfulness, and yes, faith. In stories like Rogue One, faith and the Force take center stage. A film that most would label as the true war film of the franchise is more about faith and hope than war itself. The first Jedi game we got out of the Disney era focused more on faith and devotion to the Force than any code or philosophy. In fact, the stories Disney seems to be telling, whether in the comics, novels, games, shows, or films, seems to be based around the fact that faith in the Force is more important than any Jedi code. Rey, for example, has such a devotion, faith, and connection to the Force that the codes are simply useless to her. The Force guides her, as the Force guided Qui-Gon. For some, Qui-Gon is the only true Jedi left during the prequels. Or, at least during Episode 1. Spoiler alert! Some feel that a devotion to the Force, and not the codes, are what the Jedi should be. Of course, there is no real definition of what makes a true blue or green Jedi. The fact is, the Force could will someone to follow the code, down to the letter. Although, perhaps those following the code are ignoring the will of the Force. But that is something that only the Force could know. Thus, any true Jedi would not lay judgment upon someone who is following the one and only rule necessary to be a Jedi: compassion. It takes compassion for yourself and others to find the balance needed to control one's emotions and not fall victim to the dark side's corrupting influence. For those who lack faith, the Force does not have to be about God or a spiritual universal source, or in fact, any kind of mystical bullshit. Yes, I know you think it's mystical bullshit, and that's totally okay. No one should ever force you or anyone else to believe in something that they do not want to. Don't get me wrong, I hope and wish that everyone finds or has faith and a belief in something greater than themselves. But believing in yourself more than anything else is having faith in something, and that still counts. John Williams must be pretty strong in the Force, or something, to compose and conduct some of the most inspiring, memorable, moving, and electrifying music of this or any generation. But most of all, the Force had to be very strong within Georgie Boy himself. Since there has yet to be another film to truly change the industry and the world, at least the way Star Wars did in 77 and to this very day. There may be better movies, stories, and there will always be things some people love far more than Star Wars. But one thing will remain true for all time. Star Wars changed our world for the better. If that wasn't through the power of the Force, then I guess we all need to get up off our lazy asses and make the next Star Wars. Our world needs to come together just like we did in 1977, when the entire world shared a common love, when the entire world said, "Use the Force, Luke," and knew exactly what it meant.
Joseph Campbell said that all the great myths, the primitive myths, the great stories have to be regenerated if they're going to have any impact, and that you had done that with Star Wars. Are you conscious of doing that? Are you saying, I am trying to recreate the myths of old? Or are you saying, I just want to make a good action movie?
Well, when I did Star Wars, I consciously set about to recreate myths and the classic mythological motifs. And I wanted to use those motifs to deal with issues that existed today. What these films deal with is the fact that we all have good and evil inside of us, and that we can choose which way we want the balance to go. Star Wars is made up of many themes. It's not just a single theme. One is our relationship to machines, which are fearful but is also benign. They're an extension of the human, not mean in themselves. The issues of friendship and your obligation to your fellow man and to other people that are around you. That you have control over your destiny, that you have a destiny, that you have many paths to walk down, and you may have a great destiny. If you decide not to walk down that path, your life might not be as satisfying as if you wake up and listen to your inner feelings and realize what it is that you have a particular talent for and what contributions you can make to society.
I'm just not feeling myself. I know it looks like I'm making excuses.
And inside you?
Inside me. That same force.
No one's ever really gone.
I will earn your brother's saber. One day.
I see your eyes. You already know the truth.
You remember more than you say.
Whomever you're waiting for on Jakku.
I've been in your head.
I don't want this!
Search your memories.
They're never coming back.
All you want is to be free. What? Not even you.
The rebellion is reborn today. The war is just beginning.
Rise.
I will not be the last Jedi.
Be with me. Be with me.
Weak.
Don't be afraid of who you are.
Like your parents.
My parents were strong. They saved me from you.
I feel it again.
Feel the Force flowing through you.
Let it lift you.
Rise, Rey.
Force.
The call to the light.
The heart of a Jedi lies her strength.
Rey, the Force will be with you. Always.
Always.
I'm all the Jedi.
No!
We've passed on all we know.
No!
A thousand generations living you now. But this is your fight.
Show me again the power of the darkness. And I will finish what you started.
No one for so long. Who are you?
I'm Rey.
Rey who? Rey Skywalker.
May the Force be with you all, always.
What do you want to do tonight? Oh, and if you say see Star Wars again, I'm leaving.
You don't want to leave. You want to see Star Wars.
Stop it! I have had it with you. You are weird, and I'm going home.
Jackie.
Oh, boy. That's terrible, the way she treats you.
Right?
You know, I saw Star Wars, and I'm not a movie expert, but I think it's safe to say it was the greatest film of all time.
Finally! Someone who understands.
Yeah. You know, Kelso, I always thought you were kind of dumb.
Uh-huh.
But I don't care.
You know, I don't either. It's...